Back in the early 20th century, the ecclesiastical hierarchy in Bangkok came up with a series of textbooks that all monks should study. And in it, they defined virtue in terms of body and speech. It was basically restraint of the body, restraint of your speech. And John Munn would often take issue with that, not in a public forum, but when talking with the students. A true definition of virtue would have to bring in the mind, because after all, it is your intention that makes a difference. Especially because you have intentions that you act on, that you can be virtuous to begin with, and it's the intention that determines the quality of the act, whether it will be in line with the precepts or not. If you unintentionally kill something, it's not a breach of the precepts. If you unintentionally make a false statement, again, it's not a breach of the precepts. The mind is the important part. The Buddha made a similar point when he would go out to seek those who argue that everything you experienced in terms of pleasure or pain was totally determined by past actions or by a creator God or by random chaotic events. He said in any of those cases, if that were true, and you would be a thief because of what was done in the past, or because of a creator God, or because of random events. You could kill, steal, have illicit sex, break all the precepts, and you have no responsibility in the present moment. And we're saying in that case, there would be no basis for saying that something should be done or shouldn't be done, because it already would be either totally determined or totally random. But it's because there is a principle that some things are shaped by the past, but you do have a role in shaping things with your present intentions. That's why you can be virtuous, and that's why there can be an idea of what should or shouldn't be done. So here's, we're meditating, we're working on our intentions. So it has a moral implication. After all, if virtue is restrained of your intentions, that's what we're practicing here. There's no clear line between virtue and concentration and discernment. Here again, in John Munn, he would make the point that you not only start out with a virtue to foster concentration and concentration to foster discernment, but your concentration also fosters virtue. Your discernment fosters concentration and virtue. All three of the main trainings support one another, because they're all connected right here at the intention. So as you intend to stay with the breath, that's a virtuous act in the mind. You're not thinking of killing or stealing or having illicit sex with anyone. Not even in symbolic ways. You know what John Lee's analysis, the precepts of the mind as you're getting into concentration. You don't kill, in other words, you don't kill your good qualities. You don't steal, you're not here thinking about other people's bad qualities without having asked them. You're not engaged in illicit sensuality. You're not lying. You're sitting here with your eyes closed, and your mind is practicing concentration. The message of sitting here with your eyes closed is, here I am concentrating, here I am meditating. And you really are. And you're not intoxicated. You're heedful. You realize that you have to work on your intentions if you want to be safe in thought and word and deed. So meditation is a moral act. It's good to keep that in mind, because that way the meditation connects with your daily life. There was that time when I was visiting Ajahn Uthai in Thailand. When I arrived, he was talking with a group of lay people. After I bowed down to him, he asked me, those Westerners who come to him, the monastery, what do they come for? And I said, well, they come for peace of mind. And one of the lay people in the other group said, ah, those Westerners, they go straight to the top. And John Uthai said, what do you mean straight to the top? Even common animals want peace of mind. If you're really interested in the Dharma, you have to be interested in virtue and dharma. Sila tam, they call it in Thai. Moral virtue. Remember that meditation does qualify as one of the acts of merit or acts of goodness. Because our virtue is motivated by goodwill. Our concentration is motivated by goodwill. We're trying to find some ease, well-being in the present moment, and it's in a harmless way. And our discernment should also be motivated by goodwill. We realize that if we don't clear up our defilements, we're going to suffer, other people are going to suffer. So the three trainings interpenetrate, which means that we're not here simply to relax or to engage in some stress reduction. The relaxation and the stress reduction are there to make it easier for the mind to function properly. You can make a comparison with psychiatric therapy. First, they engage in what they call symptom management. Someone comes in with a mental disease, and you have them calm down first. Then when they're calmed down, then you can actually get to the root of the problem. Where in the mind is this wrong understanding that's making you suffer? Well, it's the same with the meditation. We breathe easily. We think of the breath flowing throughout the whole body, from the top of the head down to the tips of the toes. Think of there being channels throughout the body where the breath can connect. So whatever stress we picked up in the course of the day gets washed out each time we breathe in, each time we breathe out. And in the pauses between the breaths, you can think of your awareness spreading in that sense of stillness. And as the breath gets more and more gentle, the pauses get longer and longer, the stillness gets more and more pervasive. Until you feel totally at home right here. Well, that's symptom management. Then you try to notice when the mind would still go for any of the hindrances, anything involved with greed, aversion, delusion. Why? You watch for this. It's going to happen. Our problem is all too often that when we sit here and everything is very calm, you get up and you forget that you've been meditating. You immediately go back to your old ways of thinking, functioning in the world. Right then, as you leave the meditation posture, it's not time to leave meditation. Carry your meditation, that sense of being centered and still, observant of the mind, keeping the body at ease. As you get up, as you walk around, to see when the mind does come up with something that's not quite skillful. How did it happen? What was the cause? How long does it last? And why did the mind go there? Usually the first reason is that, well, now that we're done meditating, we have work to do, we have things we have to take care of in the world outside. But maybe that's just an excuse. They have this term sumroi in Thai, which refers to criminals trying to get into a house so that their footprints can't be seen. They walk in the footprints of somebody who's already walked into the house. So there's no double pair of footprints. In the same way, a lot of our defilements, sumroi, where the parts of the mind say, well, I have to do this, I need to do that. And then when they have their chance, they take over. So you want to watch for that. That's one of the ways in which the mind justifies all kinds of different things to itself. Once you've cleared that up, then there'll be other things that you have to look into. When we talk about looking for the allure of something, it's not just one thing. There are many stages that many layers to the allure. And you keep on trying to peel them away, peel them away. Compare the allure with the drawbacks. so that you can see clearly that the allure is not really worth what you thought it was. It carries in its wake a lot of pain and a lot of trouble. And when you can see that connection clearly, that's when you can develop the dispassion that allows you to let go. And when that particular defilement is no longer an issue in your mind, it's no longer going to be an issue in your activities, and it's no longer going to be an issue for the people you deal with. Because after all, your practice impacts not only your mind, but also the people around you. Which is why as you take responsibility for your actions, and this is a lot of what virtue is all about, you take responsibility for your actions. And you're doing that not only as you move around in word and deed, but also in thought. I was listening to somebody the other day say that the spirit of the precepts is to create as little harm as possible, the greatest amount of good for the greatest number of people. All kinds of things have been done in the past based on the idea of the greatest good for the greatest number. Some pretty inhumane things, deciding that a small number has to be wiped out for the greater good of others. That's not the spirit of the precepts at all. The spirit of the precepts is you take responsibility for your actions. If you misbehave, you're the one who's responsible. You can't blame it on the misbehavior of others. So you're trying to create a mind that, in that sense, is independent. In other words, a mind whose goodness is independent of the goodness of others. Doesn't have to rely on other people. We rely on other people to show us the way, good people, knowledgeable people, to show us the way. But we're the ones who have to follow that way. And as we're following it, we're going to meet up with a lot of people who are not following the way. But we don't let that deter us. Because we know that when we're responsible for our intentions, we'll benefit and the people around us will benefit as well. We show restraint in our intentions, the virtue of our intentions. In all cases, that way we give universal safety to everybody. It's when we make exceptions in the precepts. That's when that safety becomes not universal. And the protection provided by the precepts, provided by virtue, is no longer all around. Think of the image of a fence around your house. If there's a big gap in the fence, then anything is big enough to get through the gap or expand the gap by wiggling through. We'll be able to get in. It's as if you didn't have a fence at all. It's only when the fence is totally all around. That's when it provides real protection. So as we're working on our intentions right here, right now, we're working at the source of virtue. And as we get used to being on top of our intentions, each time we breathe in, each time we breathe out, that's how our concentration helps to purify our virtue. And why meditation is a moral act.